Fauci, professor of epidemiology and infectious diseases, epidemiology at the Federal University of Goiás. Yeah. In central Brazil, Dr. Siqueira has been an advisor to the Brazilian Ministry of Health and PAHO on arbovirus surveillance, and he will present to us yellow fever, the current Brazilian outbreak and response. Please don't scare us like yesterday Professor Cooper did.
Yeah, it's going to be
yellow
much worse.
Yellow fever will go to Asia. No. Yeah. Okay, please.
Thank you so much. Thank you for this opportunity to be here discussing with you our current scenario. And it seems that when we talk about arboviruses nowadays, Brazil is on the front of that. First with dengue, then with Zika, and after this, dengue went away, Zika went away, and we were like, okay, we're not gonna catch a break. But we are so wrong about it. There was still yellow fever around. I need to acknowledge the National Immunization Program. They shared with me most of the slides that I'm gonna discuss with you today. Brazil is the largest country in Latin America, and we have basically 5,600 different municipalities in the country, and a really huge population, 203 million people estimated for this year, 209 million. Well, when we think about yellow fever, basically we are discussing two different scenarios. Silvetic yellow fever, which mosquitoes like Hemagogus and Sabetis are the main ones for us. And urban cycle that's related to Aedes aegypti. And Duane mentioned something about this yesterday. Well, in 1942, we have seen the last case of urban yellow fever in Brazil. And our historical series show irregular patterns, sometimes 7 years between outbreaks, sometimes a little longer. And but we expect some epidemic peaks every now and then. We have seen a high case fatality rate, around 38% of the cases have died in this period. But I think that the key moment for us is between 2007 and 2010, when we have seen this expansion of yellow fever transmission into the southern and south regions of the country. And this particular period of time highlighted the potential for dissemination over time and the risk for occurrence of urban cases of yellow fever, especially because these areas were not being vaccinated before. It's different from the north of Brazil and center of Brazil, which are the endemic classic areas for yellow fever. And it also highlighted the severity and case fatality rate that we were observing over time. Yesterday, I just told Duane this morning that he stole my wow factor. I prepared something to say just wow today, and he stole it yesterday when he showed one graph to you. But this is yellow fever for us until 2015. The number of cases, it basically were not higher than 90 cases each year. But everything changed. But the point is, we are discussing these huge outbreaks in 2017 and 2018, but basically it started earlier, in 2014, 2015. These are some data from the Minister of Health and the yellow fever bulletin from 2015. Oh, we have already seen an increase in disease transmission in central Brazil, and remember that this is the most affected area over time until that moment. Higher incidence in travelers because ecotourism is quite common in this area. And we have seen episodic in non-human primates, and they were spatial related to human cases. As Duane mentioned yesterday, there's always an overlap between cases in non-human primates and human cases. And it serves as an early warning system for us, and it actually works. And think about it. The recommendations in 2015, they were great recommendations. Intensify preventive vaccination with efforts to sustain high vaccine coverage in areas with recommended vaccination, and increase surveillance during the seasonal transmission period, again, focusing on early response. Amazing recommendations, 2015. The only problem is that we didn't monitor these recommendations over time. And when you look at that moment in time, spatial correlation between human cases and episodics. And we had the affected area in red, and we even were working with expanded areas for intervention at that moment. But then this happened. This is what I have shown you before, and this is now, 2017 and 2018, completely different scenario, huge number of cases, huge number of deaths in the country. And what it seems to me that we are pretty amazing at giving different names to the same thing over time. So we have this endemic area, transition area, and areas free of disease or non-vaccinated areas over time. And with the we can see the expansion of these transition areas, and then we even find something new, like temporary recommendation for vaccines, which is such a nonsense. Because once you start having cases, you are going to be vaccinating those people, and not only on a temporary manner. So we should be actually using just two colors, recommended and non-recommended vaccination over time, instead of getting these amazing names for the same thing. And this is our current scenario. We have seen that over time, vaccination was only in the green, and right now it's in the gray area, the darker gray, which means most of the country. And from 2019 on, we're going to be vaccinating everyone. There's going to be a new policy to vaccinate everyone in the country. And as I mentioned, it's the current outbreak, it's an unprecedented one. Well, we have seen that these areas should be vaccinated. And areas most affected in the past couple of years, they had lower vaccine coverage, especially for Minas Gerais state at that point in time. So cases have been occurring in areas with lower vaccination. And as you can see, red means low vaccination rates and cases. They match these areas with low vaccine coverage over time. And again, we have expanded it to new states like Espírito Santo and Rio de Janeiro state this year. And again, vaccination rates for these two states, they were pretty low compared to other endemic areas, the classic endemic areas, where you can see vaccination covered higher than 90, 95% of the population. Well, we have seen areas without recommended vaccination and with recommended vaccination in both outbreaks, 2016-17, 2017-18. And basically, we're talking about a large number of people, 11 million people, 38 million people living in these areas affected. That highlights the number of vaccines that we need to address these high transmission scenarios in previously unaffected areas, like Duane mentioned yesterday. And basically, during outbreaks, we run out of vaccines. There's not enough vaccines for everyone around. And both for, please take a look at this, there's a lighter pink and the red for 2017 and, oh sorry, this is 2018. 765 cases in 2017, 1,200 cases in 2018. 255 deaths, more than 400 deaths this year. And basically what we see is a seasonal, a very marked seasonal pattern for transmission. But if you look at episodics, you're gonna see that they start earlier. So they really are useful as an alert system for us. And what happened is that basically we didn't took that as seriously as we have should in most of the states. There's this very small municipality in Minas Gerais state last year. As soon as they started seeing episodics, they decided to vaccinate everyone in their community. And what happened later was that every single municipality around them, they had cases and they had deaths. and they had none. So if we pay closer attention to this to these early warnings, we are able to make something different. Well, little is known on these unprecedented outbreaks. There are a lot of discussion on this multicausality, expansion of the virus to areas without vaccination before, like Espírito Santo, Rio de Janeiro, and São Paulo. We have the urban segments of the cities entering the rural segments. We have limitations in monitoring vaccine coverage. Actually, we were monitoring over time the number of applied doses and not people that received doses. And remember that during outbreaks, usually even someone who has been vaccinated before gets a new shot. They go to basic health facilities to get a new shot. So it seemed that we had a really high vaccine coverage in some places, but it turned out that that was not correct. We have some limitations in epizootics in non-human primates, especially in non-endemic areas. And we are thinking about several environmental factors that are not yet explained, but we have a lot of questions and very few answers at this point here. Well, we still need to address additional causes of the outbreaks, and not only the costs with the vaccine itself. Direct costs with hospitalizations, year of life lost, unexpected expenses with health workers, additional hours of work, displacement, other services that are interrupted during outbreaks, and you need to move people around to address the yellow fever crisis. Relocation of resources affected several municipalities, especially the smaller ones. We had to hire extra hospital beds, and the direct cost for extra federal money was around $14 million, but it's much, much higher than this, the overall cost of the outbreak. Well, think about the number of vaccines that we have used over the past couple of years. Routine vaccines, 12 million. Outbreak, 32 million. Think about it. To produce and use 32 million doses of vaccines. It's quite a challenge, as Duane mentioned yesterday. And again, these years, 8 million for routine and 20 million for outbreak. Think about it, 73 million doses of vaccines for the past couple of years. It's something that really is unprecedented, even for a country like Brazil. Well, the strategies that we have developed to monitor disease over time. We have recommendations to intensify surveillance and immunization actions, especially in areas that are recently affected by the disease. We have developed a contingency plan for this scenario with epidemiological, entomological, and epizootics in non-human primates, and to increase the surveillance, immunization, lab, communication, which is quite important. Steve mentioned the social media. I'm gonna show you something that you feel quite, it's somehow funny initially, but later it becomes a disaster. Intensify vaccination, establish criteria. We started to use fractionated doses in three different states in the country. And we have established centers for emergency at the MOH. And MOH was present in supporting the states. But basically, take a look at this. This is the area previously affected by yellow fever in the country. And this is where most of the cases are located in 2018. What seems to be happening here is that we have moved 70, 80 years in time, back to early 1900s, where we have seen cases in this region before. But they were free of yellow fever for the past 40, 50, 60 years. So basically, disease was like this for most of the time. And right now we have just moved back in time for something like this. And the main challenge here is that most of the population of the country, they live in these areas around here. So that's why we needed so many vaccine doses over time. Well, so many vaccine doses, different vaccination strategies over time. Until 2016, we had the first dose at 9 months of age and reinforcement dose every 10 years. It changed recently. In 2017, the MOH adopted the recommendation from WHO on using a single dose. And in 2018, due to this huge exposed population, we started also use fractional dose for selected states, basically three states and around 80 different municipalities in the country. And so far, the evidence that we have is that even for a fractional dose, these people are protected for at least 8 years after vaccination. And it may be longer, actually. But the problem is this. Regions that were endemic before for yellow fever, they had higher vaccine coverages. Areas recently exposed, they have really lower vaccine coverage over time. So this is quite a challenge to improve vaccine coverage in so many people in such a short notice. And basically, as I mentioned, we have started fractional dose in these three states. We have seen some results on this. And basically, there's something that we need to address that we were not prepared to. And I want to talk a little about it. Well, we have seen the expansion of the virus circulation in risk areas from basically 3,200 municipalities to 4,200 municipalities, 1,000 municipalities more over the past couple of years. The factors for this expansion are still to be explained. We believe it's multifactorial. The monitoring of disease reaffirms that we have this very marked seasonal pattern, and it allows us actually to establish the prevention measures, especially based on the episodic surveillance. And vaccination will be gradually extended to all Brazilian municipalities until next year. I have included some of the references for the bulletins if you are interested, but there's one more thing that we need to understand. And this is the part that I said Steve's gonna like. Please take a look at the dates. This is February 1st. Think about demand. Demand for the vaccination was so high that drug lords, they kidnapped the nurse and some vaccines in Rio. They took the nurse to their community. They organized the lines. They vaccinated the whole community. Then they returned the nurse to the health facility with the left doses of the vaccine. They didn't keep the ones they didn't use. So this is just to highlight the demand for vaccination at that moment in time. So this is February 1st. Okay, February 8th. Vaccines has been stolen from health units in São Paulo. Again, think about demand. People were decided that they needed to be vaccinated and they started stealing doses. 7 days later. Okay, this is February 15th. 15 days later, a woman was arrested, suspected of selling fake vaccines, vaccinating people with fake vaccines. Again, demand really high. But then, this is February 19th, only 18 days later, the demand for the vaccine decreases. And Rio de Janeiro State, where the drug lords first kidnapped that nurse, they were preparing a new D-Day campaign for vaccination because the search for vaccination has dramatically decreased. 18 days interval, people. February 27th, fake news on virus mutations and vaccine efficacy reduced dramatically the search for yellow fever. So this is something that we really need to understand how it works. It's so fast, it's unbelievable fast. Within a month, we went from kidnapping, stealing, fake vaccines, to people not being, they did not want it to be vaccinated anymore within a month. This is so incredible. And again, the same thing, we're gonna see some vaccines again available, but no demand for it, is 25, 27th, after run to the health units, we have vaccines left everywhere. So a month later, vaccine coverage under the initial goal in Rio, we were expecting it to be really high due to the initial demand. And what happened was that they didn't want to be vaccinated anymore. Risk perception changed so dramatically. That's it. Thank you.